Survivors of the Shoah Visual History Foundation. Date, September 10th, 1997. Survivor, Barry Gourary. Interviewer, Dina Cohen. City, Montclair, New Jersey. Country, USA. Language, English. My name is Dina Cohen. Today is September 10th, 1997. I will be conducting an interview with Barry Gourary in Montclair, New Jersey, USA. The interview will be in English. Could you state your name and spell it, please?
My name is Barry, that's B as in boy, A-R-R-Y, Shalom, I usually use the middle initial, S as in Sam, H-O-L-O-M, and the last name is Gourary, G as in George, O-U-R-A-R-Y.
And your name at birth, what was that?
Shalom Der Gourary, same spelling, except that the middle name, in this case, the sequence of names was changed. Shalom comes first, Ber second, and then comes Gourary.
Were you known by any other names?
At one time in my life, when I was a Latvian citizen, my legal name was Shalom's Ber's Gourary's.
You want to spell that too?
No.
Okay. No. And when were you born?
On February the 10th, 1923.
And the city and country of your birth?
I was born in Rostov on the Don in Russia. At that time it was the Soviet Union.
And did you grow up in Rostov on Don?
No, we left Rostov when I was about 3 months old.
And who was we?
We being my parents, my grandparents, and I don't know who else. At the age of 4 months, I did not keep a very adequate inventory yet.
Could you describe your parents?
Yes. I should really start with my grandparents, if you don't mind.
Okay.
My grandparents were the Grand Rabbi, or in Hebrew, Admur, Yosef Yitzchak Schneerson, of blessed memory. He was at the time the Rebbe of Lubavitch. He was a descendant of a long, long generation dating back to the Alter Rebbe, Rabbi Schneer Zalman, who was known as Rabbi Schneer Zalman Boruchovich. And my grandmother was Nechama Dina Schneerson, of a different line of Schneersons, but still with the same name. Now, these were my maternal grandparents. My mother was Hannah Schneerson, the eldest of three daughters of my grandparents. The other two were Musia and Sonia. And my father was Samarius Gourary, in Hebrew, Shmaryohu Gourary, a member of the well-known, at the time, Gourary clan from Kremenchuk.
What is the origin of the Gourary name?
I am told that the Gourary name dates back to, what is it, the 16th century. And it has an interesting history. At the time, there was a very well-known rabbi in Prague, Czechoslovakia. His name was Rabbi Levi. Now, he had written a number of important treatises. One of them was a commentary on the Bible. And as was customary in those days, he took a passage from the Bible to serve as title of his work. The passage he chose was Gourary. Gourary means a lion's whelp or a lion's cub. It comes from the passage in the Bible which says, a lion's cub is Judah. So, since he wrote his book and he titled it that way, later his children and grandchildren took the name Gourary as their last name. That's the story.
And what was your father like?
My father was a very energetic doer. He also liked to study. The subject he liked to study particularly was Hasidus. This is a branch of, it's a mixture in a sense of Kabbalah and mysticism. And he was in particularly interested in the kind of Hasidus that was preached by my grandfather and by his predecessors in the Rebavitcher chain. But otherwise, father was a very energetic man. He spent many years first at the yeshiva in Lubavitch, in fact. And interestingly enough, he had a roommate. His roommate's name was Beryl Haskind. It so happens that I married Beryl Haskind's daughter a little later on.
And your mother, what was she like?
My mother was a very caring, loving person. Very lovable, very loving, very lovable, with extremely strong-willed. And in many ways, she set the family agenda. In the years which I remember, which I remember already on my own without being told so much about it, I remember that starting in 1930, when my grandfather became seriously ill, he had multiple sclerosis, she set the family agenda at making it possible for grandfather to continue to his work as the Lubavitcher Rebbe. He needed a great deal of help. And to a large extent, of course, to a large extent, thanks to his own iron will and to the help of many friends, but also to a very substantial extent, thanks to my mother and her complete dedication to helping him continue. And with some help from me, he was able to carry on until his death in 1950.
You said that you didn't grow up in Rostov-on-Don. Where
No.
did you move to after that?
I don't remember the exact sequence. As I said, I didn't start keeping notes until after we left Russia. We left Russia when I was four. But we moved to Moscow. We moved to Leningrad. Since my grandfather was very active at the time in organizing Jewish schools and in making sure that there was an opportunity for Jewish children to study the traditional Hebrew texts and to study them in a way that was appropriate and to teach Hasidus to them, he was found to be against the regime. He was openly so. He was at one point arrested, condemned to death for his counter-revolutionary activities. Remember, those were the years of the very violent kind of Bolshevism in Russia. And he later on, under severe pressure from the United States, and thanks, by the way, to people like to his followers in the United States, people like Rabbi Israel Jacobson, my late father-in-law, Beryl Haskind, the Kramer brothers, particularly Sam Kramer, who was a very prominent lawyer. Sam Kramer's partner, who was New York State Senator Kleinfeld, and a number of other people, many of whom I just can't remember. He was finally released from, he was finally forgiven, I shouldn't say forgiven, his sentence was commuted to 3 years or more in jail, and then in Kostroma, which was a very undesirable area in Russia. With a little more pressure, he was finally expelled from the Soviet Union, and with him went the whole family. Now, again, I should mention one person whom I did not yet mention, who was very active in that, and that was Mordechai Dubin, who was a deputat, that meant a representative in the Latvian Sejm. Sejm was the legislature. And who did everything that could possibly be done to help my grandfather get out of Russia and then provide him with a stable place to live in Latvia. Thanks to Dubin, in fact, my grandfather, his family, his immediate spouse, and the other members of his family, like ourselves, were given Latvian citizenship. And we found a home.
What was your home like in Latvia?
Well, it was a peaceful oasis. It was very peaceful. I don't have very many memories of that. Let's face it, I left Russia when I was four. We left Riga when I was probably about nine. So, again, I don't have too many Riga collections, except for a very peaceful and pleasant environment, and pleasant times at the beach, for example, at Bulduri, and various other such insignificant, but yet very, very important parts of daily life.
And did your grandfather have a following in Latvia?
Yes, my grandfather had a substantial following in Latvia, starting with Mordechai Dubin himself, who was a very important man. By the way, I should say about one other thing about Dubin. He was a very close friend and confidant of the then strongman of Latvia. The strongman was Karlis Umanis. And that had a lot to do with his power and his influence. He was extremely important for the Jewish community in that he provided the Jewish community in Latvia with a firm and stable base, not typical in many other European countries.
Did you go to school in Latvia?
I'm sorry. I should fill in a few more names in Latvia, names like Yudovich, Mordechai Feifetz, many others. Unfortunately, my memory is not very good, so I cannot spell them out, but there were many, many of them. Interestingly enough, though, if I may say that, in those days, the number of followers was still relatively small as compared to what it is now, because of the fact that the means of communication were so different. It was before telephones were available. It was before typewriters were readily available. Written words had to be written. If you wanted multiple copies, there was no Xerox. There were people who would copy these, like scribes. And that, in turn, limited the number. And yet, it provided also another aspect to it. Because of the fact that there were fewer people, they were closer. we could remember individuals who were members of my grandfather's following. We knew their parents, we knew of their grandparents, sometimes several generations. We knew their children. It was more built on a family structure than it is, than is typical nowadays of a movement.
You said you left Latvia when you were 9?
Approximately. My memory is not that good. And that goes, by the way, that comment goes for everything I say in this interview. Dates may be off a little. But there were two important events that took place while we were partly in Latvia, and yet the events themselves took place in Poland. First, the marriage of my uncle Mendel to Mendel Schneerson. Schneerson in his own right, not my grandfather's. And my aunt Musia. Musia was my mother's middle sister. Mother was the oldest, Musia was the second. And that took place probably about 1928. It took place in Poland. If I remember correctly, that one was in Warsaw. And then there was another important moment, and that was the wedding of my younger aunt, which took place later. And it took place again in Poland, this time, if I remember correctly, in Druskinik. And Sonia married a young man by the name of Menachem Mendel Hornstein, who was related to the Schneerson family. He was a very, very distant cousin. Now, in the meantime, grandfather was working very hard trying to save the religious Jewry of Russia. And he did that both by trying to get others to do it, by doing it himself, by having his immediate entourage do that. But one of the important initiatives he undertook was to go to America in order to build a following here and in order to get those people to work for the release of many of the Orthodox Jewish dissidents who were being jailed in Russia and in order to make it possible for some of them to get out of Russia with their families. That was a trip that he undertook in 1929 and 1930. It was most of a year, partly 29, partly 30. My father went with him on that trip. My grandfather also wanted his middle son-in-law, Mendel Schneerson, to come with him. But Mendel Schneerson and his wife Musia chose to pursue their own ends, which at that point involved going to Berlin, Germany, and studying at the university at Berlin. My uncle was studying natural philosophy, the name at that time given to the science of physics, and mathematics. From my observations of his actions in later life, I found that while he hadn't learned much natural philosophy and mathematics, he learned an enormous amount about methods of organization from the movements that were at that time active in Germany, namely from the Nazi movement. And he also learned the value of propaganda from them. He employed it to his own ends later on. So this was a very important period for him until the time came when the Nazi climate became such that he had to escape from Russia. That was circa 1932, probably. During the time of between 1929 and 1930, when my grandfather and my father were in America, my mother and I went for a visit to Musa and Mendel in Berlin. And so that was another departure from Latvia, where our official residence was still Latvia. And that was a very interesting kind of period. On the one hand, I enjoyed it. My uncle was very, very, my uncle and I were very friendly at the time. He did all kinds of things for me, like take me to the zoo, and you will see a picture resulting from that. Picture in the zoo where I sit with two little lion cubs, one of them sitting on my lap, the other one lying at my feet, taking a picture. I'm not quite sure who was more worried, the cubs or I. They had more experience than I did, because this was an opportunity afforded to many visitors. At that time, I also visited, well, of course, we saw Mendel and Musa a great deal. And one of the things I remember from that time was games. Now, these were games that were being played by my uncle and his brother. His brother was a very peculiar duck, very capable man. His name was Lova, which is Russian for label, or for the Hebrew would be Yehuda Leib. And Leibel was an atheist. He also was counter-revolutionary. So he managed to be hated by two groups, not one. Anyway, he made his life out of Russia, his way, I should say, out of Russia, and came to Berlin. In Berlin, he and my uncle used to play games. When I would visit, I would often climb up onto the top of a large wardrobe in their living room. It was a living room, bedroom combination. In Europe, there wasn't that much space. And their game consisted of pulling two beds together and then trying to jump over that. I've seen many more successful, very fewer successful jumps than I have seen spills. But it was very interesting to watch for a kid of my age at the time. In any case, there are other memories of Berlin.
What was your impression of Berlin as a young boy?
In those days, it was a very interesting city. But again, I don't have such detailed recollections. Remember again, this was a trip when I was about 7. You don't have that many memories. I have one memory, I should say, which I did not describe from Russia, if I may at this stage. In fact, it's my only good memory of that. And that was a memory of visiting my grandfather in jail. That was at the time when we were by no means sure that he was going to come out of it alive. I remember going there with my grandmother, my great-grandmother, and my mother. Women were safer, see, in those days. That's why my father was already in trouble. He was in jail, too. I remember visiting my grandfather. I remember the appearance of the jail. I think I remember it. A large hall with something like a row of cells along one side. And it's almost like a corridor with windows which were barred, small grates on the windows. Occasionally a grate would be opened and someone would come out and he would jump out through the window and just talk to his visitors. Grandfather wasn't permitted to do that. I asked why. Well, only those who are not condemned to death are permitted to do that. The golovniki, that means those who are expected to be killed, are not permitted out. And I remember the waiting room of that particular jail. We sat. There was a large hole in the wall. I never understood what it was for. Although now I suspect it was probably for somebody to sit behind it and listen. Since in those days, a recording apparatus was not so readily available. But I'm sorry, this was a throwback to an earlier era.
Getting back to 1929, 1930.
Yes.
How successful was your father and grandfather's trip to the United States?
Unfortunately, successful only in the sense of inspiring my grandfather's followers and a few others. But 1929 and 1930 were the times when the Depression struck. And so it was extremely difficult to get any large-scale financial help. People were concerned about other things, not about other people's welfare, but about their own. And it was a very difficult time. So, successful in some ways, but a failure in financial matters. Still, ever since then, and even before then, thanks again to the people I had already mentioned, the United States has always helped my grandfather and many of his followers escape the very worst of consequences.
What do you recall about their return to Riga?
I don't. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I have no memories of that. I do know that my grandfather's illness dates back to that time. Apparently, during his period in the United States, he fasted a great deal. And that apparently had something to do with it, although I am not sure that it had anything directly to do. The disease is not traceable to any very specific origin.
And when did you leave Latvia?
Probably sometime around 1932 or 33. I'm not sure. And then we moved to Warsaw at first.
Do you remember why you left?
Yes, the reason was primarily that my grandfather felt that he wanted to have a broader field of activity. Spread God's word to many more people. In Latvia, that wasn't possible. So he moved to Warsaw. Life changed. Gradually. The movement grew larger. The family aspect of the movement became weaker.
We'll discuss more on the next tape.
Okay.
Interview with Barry Gourary, tape number 2. We were talking about your move to Warsaw, and you said that things changed dramatically at that point. Could you describe that a little?
Well, I shouldn't say dramatically at that point. It was the beginning of a change. The change consisted of the fact that the circle of followers of my grandfather's increased. Now, to some extent, that was exactly what he wanted, because he felt he had a message, a Torah message and a Hasidus message, that he wanted to convey to a larger number of people. Yet, it also meant that there were many more newer adherents. At the beginning, this was a gradual change. Later on, when he would come to the United States, it was a major change. Methods of communication gradually also changed. I don't know exactly at what point. I'm, in a sense, outlining the process rather than telling you milestones. But a rabbi generally, there's three important functions that the rabbi performs. There are many others, I'm sure. One is to convey the formal message of Hasidus. Those are formal lectures called Ma'amarim in Hebrew, and they are regarded as God's voice speaking through the Rebbe. Secondly, there are talks, informal talks, in which the Rebbe recounts various events, puts his interpretation on them, and discusses things with his various followers. And then, of course, there is Yechidus, the one-on-one visit that that Hasidim make to the Rebbe in order to get advice. In the old days, the advice was in ways of worshiping the Almighty and improving one's moral condition, one's moral performance, if you will. As the years went on, this changed. People began to ask the Rebbe for advice in earthly matters. Now, in those days, my grandfather was beginning to suffer from his illness. As I said already, he had multiple sclerosis. And so he frequently needed help. And on days when there were evenings when there would be Yechidus, I would often be available to him. So if he touched the little bell he had on his desk, I could hear it and come to him to provide whatever assistance he needed. It often ended up with me listening for many hours while I was sort of standing behind the back door to the room. I didn't listen so much to the every detail, but I certainly got a very strong impression of the kind of discussions there were. And I heard about the various unfortunate circumstances in which people found themselves, illness, lack of income, problems of various sorts. Anti-Semitism was such a prevalent force that it influenced everything Jews did at the time. And that made a very strong impression on me at the time, I remember. Obviously, people who saw the Rebbe got a great deal of moral support from him. Advice, direction, moral support. And yet there was also another aspect to it. I remember that once my grandmother was considering things very carefully. Grandfather had told her that he had accumulated a substantial sum of money of his own, and he wanted to talk to her about how, what he should do. She probably wanted some things, what should be done with that and all. Well, my grandmother considered it. She considered it very seriously because rarely did grandfather have any substantial amounts of money. By the time she made up her mind, it turned out that grandfather had had a few visitors at Yechidus. Some of them had complained that they had no income, they didn't have money to marry off a daughter, other problems of this sort, they were ill. And grandfather would open his drawer, give this one some money. That was some money. By the time grandmother had made up her mind, there was nothing to worry about. There was no money left. So, in a sense, people got support, which was moral guidance, moral support, and within the possibilities, financial support from the Rebbe.
What was your relationship like with him?
With whom?
With your grandfather, the Rebbe.
He was my, in a very real sense, he was my leader, he was the man whose words always showed the right direction. I was able always to show the right direction. There's often a saying among Hasidim that every Hasid can have only one Rebbe. There is no replacement. And that's true here. But of course, as years go on, one's attitude, one's own agenda changes. Mine changed in time. Now, perhaps you should ask me at this stage what your next question is.
I wanted you to describe your home in Warsaw. Who lived with you? Where did you live?
In Warsaw, as I remember, there was one street which was part of the Jewish area called Nalewki. Nalewki was very readily recognizable on the Sabbath. Every store was closed. And the very, very, very rarely occasional open store would be surrounded by a whole throng who would be protesting. On the Sabbath, it should be closed. On one side of that street, not too far from it, I don't remember the exact geography, was a city, street called Novolipki. And we lived on Novolipki, I think it was number 6. My grandfather lived at the other end of Nalewki, on Plac Muranowski. Muranov, M-U-R-A-N-O, with an apostrophe over the O-W, was an important Jewish section of Warsaw at the time. And grandfather lived on Plac Muranowski. I remember that we had a very nice home. We had nice furniture. My mother always had a feel for the elegant. And she always knew how to make a place warm. But we spent a great deal of time at my grandfather's house, of course.
What about your religious education?
Religious education in those days for me was primarily with a tutor, Melamed, so-called. Now, the word Melamed obviously means something even in English, because there are so many Jews named Melamed, or various versions of that. That means a teacher. I had a number of them. None of them really stick in my mind as being that outstanding that I would remember the names. But that was where I learned my Hebrew. I didn't get very much education on the secular side. In later years, we moved out of Warsaw to Otwock. Otwock was a spa about 20 or 30 miles from Warsaw. And we moved there because grandfather's condition was getting worse, and it was thought that it would be better if he lived in a place which had a particularly good climate. Now, I'm sorry, you asked me a question. I was trying to answer it in a roundabout way.
I was asking you about your education.
My education, yes. Later on, when we moved to Otwock, I ended up going to the yeshiva. Again, I had a tutor. I was treated differently than the other kids were. Not always, by the way, to my advantage. In many ways, I wish I had been treated more like them. But I had a tutor, or in later years, somebody, a young man about my age, with whom we were just partners, in a sense, in the study. And so I studied there. Occasionally, I had some tutoring in Russian. It didn't take. See, one of the problems is that the language problem. I started out in life speaking Russian because that was the language. And, of course, Yiddish. And, of course, the written Hebrew, because that's the language of the prayers. I continued in Latvia. I tried to learn Latvian. Latvian is a very unusual language. It's one of a group of only two such languages, the Baltic languages, which contained Latvian and Lithuanian. And by now I retained very few words in that language. I didn't learn that much of it because in the circle in which I was involved, Russian was still paramount, and so was Yiddish. There was no need for that language. We moved to Poland. In Poland, I did learn Polish. I still remember a little bit of it here and there, because I also learned some of the Polish literature. But that was about the extent of my secular education. I should describe for you a little bit the yeshiva in Otwock. Now, what I'm jumping to is the period after the family left Warsaw and we now settled in Otwock. Otwock is spelled O-T-W-O-C-K, but the C is pronounced always as a T-Z in Polish. Otwock was a relatively smaller town. I mean, not Warsaw was, of course, the center of Poland. Otwock was probably, I would guess, about 20,000 people. It was primarily a spa for people who had tuberculosis. And the yeshiva moved there. I don't know why. I think it was a very bad move, bad decision from a health point of view. Tuberculosis is a highly contagious disease. In those days, there was no cure for it. And there was a lack of understanding also of how to avoid infection. But what happened was that the yeshiva ended up renting a house with a large tract of land around it. Actual space in the house was not that much. And so the dormitory consisted of beds stacked one next to the other, touching. Rarely was there a good passage. You often had to walk on one bed in order to get to the other one. There was no plumbing. There was very little water that was piped into the building. There was no water pressure available from the town. What had to be done was that the superintendent and his wife had to pump up the water manually into a tank on the roof. So obviously very small quantities of it were used. And you could see them working hard, maybe a total of 8 hours a day, pumping water. I'm talking about him 4 hours and her 4 hours, which is a back-breaking task, really. This was a big wheel, and you had to stand there and turn it. The toilets were outhouses, smelly outhouses. There were no bathrooms. There was no facilities for washing, except for a mikveh, a ritual bath. In this kind of environment, it is no great surprise that there was a proliferation of bedbugs and lice. You could often sit at the table and study, and then you would see lice crawling on the colors. People were on their hair. Not very pleasant. Those young people were undernourished. There wasn't enough of food. There was no money for food. I was one of the rich guys, you know. When I got home, I got food. They often didn't. They would get one warm meal. The one warm meal would consist of a plate of bouillon and maybe a little piece of chicken swimming in it. Very often the bouillon was mostly water. So that kind of a food, that kind of a life, and the presence of tubercular patients around led to frequent infections. And some of the people came down with it. And it was very, very rare that they completely recovered. Well, I'll probably be switching back and forth.
What was your home like in Otwock?
My grandfather, there was a large house that was owned by a broker, Mr. Berlin. He was a broker of some kind. I'm not sure what he brokered. But he used to live in Warsaw, and this was really a property that was more or less an investment property. There were several buildings on that property. There was the main house. There was a secondary building. Then there was a garage with an apartment over it for the janitor. And then there was a small store with an apartment over it for the store owner. The store was a general store. The garage held a car that hadn't seen the road in many years. It was mostly a showpiece. But the large house had four apartments and a few spare rooms. The ground floor was my grandfather's. One half of it was his apartment. It consisted of a bedroom, a library, a dining room, a small porch, and a kitchen. It had one bathroom and one toilet. It also had a large veranda, probably 30 feet long, along the side of the house. And some of the pictures you see of my grandfather's earlier years were taken on that veranda. Grandfather would often sit in it and work there. There was almost a mirror image of that on the other of that apartment on the other side. It consisted of my grandfather's study, our grandfather's secretariat, a room for a shul or a congregation, and a veranda. And in addition to this, that describes the lower floor where my grandfather lived. On the upper floor, there were two major apartments. One was Mr. Berlin's, which he used on occasional weekends, and the other one was a Mr. K, who lived there, apparently, I would suggest that with his wife and with his girlfriend, and who was a TB sufferer. And Mr. K would often spend his time on the front lawn, trying to get the fresh air. And he would cough. He was reasonably careful. He would spit it into a little spittoon that he held. But nevertheless, I am not so sure that this was in accordance with modern standards. I don't think we would have exposed the visiting public that readily to that, because occasionally he did spit on the ground. And of course, they are airborne infections. Now, the secondary building was the one in which we lived. And the apartment in which we lived, at one time that entire building was one building, then it was subdivided into several apartments, then we had one apartment. And of course, since there were several apartments there, what we needed was an electric meter for each of the apartments. Now, it so happened we didn't have an electric meter. An electric meter would have cost about 70 zlotys, as I remember. And somehow everybody thought that that was much too much money. So we just used candles. It was an interesting period. It was not... I often ended up actually sleeping in my grandfather's apartment. I forgot now for what reason. Not so much in his own apartment as in his study. Grandfather's study and the room of his secretariat, his library, various places I used to sleep. And there were lots of books there. So after I went to bed and got under the covers, I would pull out a flashlight, get a book, pull a blanket over my head and read. And so I ended up reading the old Hebrew literature and some of the modern Hebrew literature like Bialik and various other modern Hebrew writers, etc., etc. Literature which might not have been normally handed to me intentionally, but it gave me a much broader picture of the world.
What other kinds of things did you read? Did you read any secular literature?
Probably. I learned to read Polish, and so occasionally I would get hold of a Polish newspaper. I certainly read some of the poetry of Adam Mickiewicz. I read various other poems. A za tego króla Jana, co to po obach był pogana, przyszli posły I rozjemcy, ratuj królu, giną Niemcy. That's a poem, I think, by Czarska. I still remember. Henryk Sienkiewicz, various other writers. I don't know to what extent it was formal, to what extent it was informal, but it was interesting. But I never learned many of the other subjects, like I never learned, for example, geography, or various other subjects that one should know. So my education was somewhat cockeyed, shall we say.
What do you remember about your grandfather's library? What did it smell like?
Well, in those days, my grandfather's library was probably several thousand books, not that many, probably 10,000 at most, if that. And it smelled, the very old books, of course, tend to be partly decayed. So they have an odor. The older they are, the more authoritative they say, you might think they are. Grandfather also had other interests. He often liked to keep track of what opponents did. So I found in his library, for example, copies of the Bible written in Latin. So it's not the Hebrew Bible. Or copies of the Bible, the Hebrew Bible translated into Latin, but with comments by various priests. So he could see which way things were going. He continued that particular interest, and his librarian secretary, his librarian private secretary, Chaim Lieberman, who managed to get to this country and lived to the age of about 100. So, but he used to bring him every Friday, he would bring grandfather a new box of books. And in his free time, grandfather would study it. Nothing pleased him more than reading. That was one of his great, great pleasures. I contracted that disease to some extent. So I also loved to read.
What else did you enjoy as a young boy?
Being bad.
In what way?
In various little ways. But then there were more serious matters. Poland was a virulently anti-Semitic country. We lived at one end of Otwock. The yeshiva was at the other end. By the time I had to go, every day I had to go from home to the yeshiva and then back. Now there were two ways of going. Going on foot, which was what most people did, or going on a bicycle, which bad guys did. I managed to acquire a bicycle. The roads were mostly unpaved. There were a few paved streets. We were at the intersection, our house was at the intersection of Ulica Bolesława Prusa. That's the name of a famous Polish poet. And Ulica Doktora Cybulskiego. I don't know what his achievements were, but his street was not paved. So it was a sea of mud in the rainy season. As we would walk up Prusa, we would pass the pharmacy, which was in town. Then I had to take, I think, right, and then so on. And we would walk by the church. And almost invariably, when a Jewish boy walked by there, there would be a few rocks go thrown his way. And I remember one day going there, and that there was more than a few rocks thrown at me. One of them hit me in the glasses, penetrated my cheek. It was obviously sharp, and it was infuriating. It broke my glasses. Well, as I say, I had been a bad boy. When I would ride the bike, I needed protection against dogs. So what I did was to buy little guns, a gun, which would be a pop gun. It would just make noise, but now it would have no bullets. I had two such guns. And one of them I had drilled through, so it could put a shot to something. I pulled out the wrong one, and I shot the guy who had thrown the rocks at me. Well, I got him in the neck. A Jew was not supposed to do those things. A Jew was supposed to turn tail and run in Poland. So what I did was very infuriating. There were quite a number of sermons. And there was a pogrom was in the making. After that, I was in hiding for a couple of weeks. We found that the police chief, somebody found that the police chief did take money. The police chief finally managed to explain it away. Of course, after he took a sufficient amount of money. And there was no program.
And approximately when was that?
37, 38, somewhere in that vicinity.
How did your family react to all of this?
Oh, I was a baddie. I was a baddie, no question about it. I built a chaya. Of course.
You said you were in hiding for a while. Where were you?
I was in hiding actually in Centos, among the kids who were among the retarded kids. Did I already discuss Centos? Not. No.
Not on the tape, but
okay.
We'll discuss that on the next tape.
Okay, I will discuss that in the next tape.
Interview with Barry Gourary, tape number 3. We were talking about the rock throwing incident in Otwotsk and you going into hiding.
Yes.
And you mentioned the place.
I went into hiding primarily at Centos. Centos was an organization which was managed by my great-granduncle, Moshe Hornstein, and his wife, Musia. Now, Centos was a home for the mentally deficient orphans, Jewish mentally deficient and orphans. And it was maintained by the Jewish Kehila, or Jewish community of Warsaw. It was a large, it had large grounds, quite a number of buildings, and some of the kids there were ones whom one might suspect would do such a ridiculous thing as trying to shoot somebody who's just trying to stone you in a peaceful way. See, after all, a Jew is supposed to take it. Well, after a while, the police chief was bought off. I gave him for examination the gun which hadn't been drilled through. He concluded that this must have been accidental, that something fell into it, and that there was no intent to harm this young Polish patriot who only was trying to do his duty by stoning a Jewish kid. And the whole thing was gradually forgotten. I think that was only one of many, many episodes, but I have often had a very strong attitude towards those who would harm me or other Jews or for that matter, any other group to which I belonged. And so it should be no surprise to you if I say that later on in life, I spent most of my life in the defense business. Can't help it. Comes through in the long run. Anyway, let me just describe briefly the Hornstein family while I'm at it. Musia Hornstein was the daughter of the she was the daughter of the Maharash. Now, the Maharash was Rabbi Shmuel. Let me explain the acronym. Hebrew has a love for acronyms. Historically, it probably dates to the fact that so many people were trying to interpret the Bible in different ways. They have tried to get every word to stand for a number of different things. One of these would be abbreviations. So the habit got started that way, partly. Maharash means our teacher, Merenu, our teacher, Horav, the rabbi, and then comes the name Shmuel. So Maharash. My great-grandfather, after whom I was named, would be Maharshab, because his name was Sholem Ber. So it would be Maharshab. My grandfather was the Maharyat, Merenu, Horav, Yisif, Yitzchok. That's where the Yatz comes from. So that's the acronym. But she was the daughter of the Maharash, who was the son of the Tzemach Tzedek, who was the son of the Mittele Rebbe, who was in turn the son of the founder of Hasidus, the Alter Rebbe. Her husband was Meisha Hornstein, and they had a number of children. The ones I remember offhand are Rachel, and the two men, Shmuel and Menachem Mendel, and Sarah. Now, Menachem Mendel, their son Menachem Mendel, married my youngest aunt, Sonia. In other words, my mother's youngest sister, Sonia. His older brother, Shmuel, married a woman by the name of Bronka, and they had a child by the name of Miriam. She was the one and only survivor of that particular family. She now lives in Israel. She had been saved, shielded by a Polish family. And after the Shoah, we managed to get her out of Poland and into Israel. And nowadays, or at least the last I had heard, she was living in Kibbutz Yisrael with her family. The Hornsteins managed this CentOS organization, as I already outlined. Yatvotsk itself, if I'm to describe the people there, there were the local people who primarily provided the necessities of life, like little stores or various or services of that sort, and people who came there looking for a cure. And finally, there was a fairly large group of commuters. The broker Berlin, whose house my grandfather rented, was one of those. Of course, he stayed in Warsaw all the time. Some people actually commuted both ways in every day, although that was both time-consuming and expensive.
We talked about your home in Otvotsk. Could you describe, though, a typical Shabbos in your home?
Well, Shabbos generally starts, remember, every Jewish holiday starts the evening before. So Shabbos starts at sunset, or rather 18 minutes before sunset on the Friday. And then when you're supposed to go to shul and recite the mincha prayer, then the Maariv prayer and Kabbalat Shabbat. Kabbalat Shabbat or Kabbalat Shabbos, depending on which particular pronunciation of Hebrew you prefer, is the welcoming of the Sabbath. Sabbath is being welcomed in as a queen. After that prayer, these prayers are all said in the company of at least nine others. In other words, you need 10 people to have a minyan. Minyan is the Hebrew word meaning the number. The number being 10. It has to be at least 10. And between Mincha and Maariv, some time has to pass by, so people used to chat, study, listen to some words from wise men, whatever, socialize. And then after these Mincha and Kabbalah Shabbat and Maariv prayers, one would go home and one would say the Kiddush prayer. After that, Kiddush prayer is said in a glass of wine, one drinks the wine, one parcels out a little bit of the wine to everyone who is supposed to be listening to your Kiddush and depending on it. Then you break bread. In the honor of the Sabbath, it's two loaves of bread and you cut one of them. But the idea of having two of them means that you're specially prepared for the Sabbath. Then you eat dinner. Dinner has to consist of important foods to welcome the Sabbath, namely fish, usually a soup after that, and usually meat after that. That's a big meal, and that's important to be welcoming the Sabbath. After that, the after the meal prayer, benching, so-called, or birchat hamazon, more officially. After that, one would usually sing a little, various sacred songs, Hasidic songs. Unfortunately, I'm a very poor, my last name is not singer. It is Gourary. And let me assure you that lions don't sing well. So I have no claim whatsoever to that. But people do sing at the meal and after the meal, special Shabbos songs often. There are various Hasidic songs. Some of these songs are sung in the shul. Some of them are sung during and after dinner. And then one is expected to rest. One's supposed to devote a good deal of attention to one's wife on a Sabbath, although many men I know have tended to give their attention more to their holy books, like sitting up all night and studying. Then, in the morning, get up, if possible, go to the mikveh, which means the ritual bath again. Then go to shul. And at the shul, one would first study some to some extent, chat, socialize. Then we would say the shachris prayer, which is the first prayer, morning prayer. Then we would say the musaf, musaf being the additional prayer. And it's an additional prayer in honor of a holiday, in this case, the Sabbath. After that would come Kiddush, again the blessing on the wine, then meal, and then Mincha, and then the third meal of the day, and then Mariv and Havdalah, Havdalah being the end of the Sabbath. But throughout this, there was often an opportunity to see the Rebbe and to listen to his wisdom, either in the shul or in occasionally visiting him and actually staying there at his table. It was not so common among Russian Jews to come to the table. It was more of a private affair for the Rebbe with his family. But the closer we got to Poland, the more we got of that. In Poland, it was very customary to come to the table. And of course, the guests would be honored. He would be given a little glass of wine and asked to say L'chaim. L'chaim meaning to life. And in that way, invite them to participate in a small way in the meal. They might be given something, some other food in addition. But the Sabbath is devoted to prayer, family, rest, and study. Always the idea of worshiping the Almighty. That's the primary purpose of creation, the Hasidic view.
As a boy, who attended the Sabbath meals in your home? How many people were there?
When I was young?
Yeah. Growing up in Poland, when you have clearer memories.
Grandfather almost always had. We used to eat at grandfather's for the Sabbath meal. Almost always, there would be a few people who would be invited. And there were two kinds of people, important visitors, poor visitors. And of course, there often were schlemiels. And I was chronic invitees who couldn't make a life for themselves. So they were invited, they were served a nice meal, and something nice would be said to them. And you try to improve people as much as possible, but if you can't improve them, you at least try to make sure that they survive and do well as they can.
What about holidays? Did you have a favorite holiday when you were growing up?
Favorite holiday? Each holiday is so different. I mean, Pesach requires preparations before, in terms of cleaning the house, removing every shred of possible sourdough or chametz. Pesach also involves the whole ritual of baking matzah. Matzah, after all, is a mitzvah. It's one of the commandments. And it's important, therefore, it has to be made from flour, which has been especially prepared for that. The flour we should have guarded it to make sure that it does not get sour. The dough doesn't get sour. If water fell into the flour, you wouldn't use the flour. Now, for Pesach, one had to have special dishes, because dishes which were used with chametz were not acceptable. So it's a whole period of preparation. In addition to that, of course, comes Erev Pesach. Erev Pesach, Erev meaning the eve before. Eve before Pesach was the day during which the Bible says all the Chorim, all the firstborn in Egypt were smitten dead. As one of the ways in which to get the Jews out. Well, now, being very careful people, Jews looked at that and they said, well, now, how do we make sure that one of our firstborn doesn't get smitten dead? Well, might be best if we fasted. So every firstborn is supposed to fast on the eve of Passover. But people don't like to fast. People like to eat. Well, when the learned rabbis looked at that, it turned out, of course, that if the eve of Passover were turned into a special yontif, into a holiday, then one would no longer be permitted to fast. So this is a way of getting out of the fast. How does one make it into a holiday? One makes it into a holiday by completing a very important task, a mitzvah, a very important mitzvah. The one chosen is to finish the study of a volume of the attracted, that is, of the Talmud. If you finish the track attracted of the Talmud, then you do that in the shul. Everybody who listens to this has participated in a great accomplishment. Therefore, it's yontif. Therefore, they don't have to fast. Now, then there are two ways of doing it, the active way and the passive way. The active way, of course, is to finish a chapter of the Talmud. Unfortunately, that takes work. The passive way is to listen to somebody else finish the chapter to the Talmud. Well, the Schneerson family and the Gourary family never believed in passive ways of doing things. So my grandfather, who was firstborn, used to have a siyum, that is the finishing of the chapter. My uncle, my father was not firstborn. My uncle, Mendel Schneerson, was also firstborn, so he would also finish his tractate. And I was firstborn, therefore I also had to finish the tractate. And my grandfather would finish something that he liked, like he was, that time he was interested in one subject, he finished the tractate relating to that. My uncle, well, he would finish something he could do fast, but he could do things awfully fast. And I will admit, I used to look for a short one. So there is a tractate Horius, which is the shortest one, almost the shortest one. There's Tomid, which is even shorter. Then there's Makot, which is only about almost 30 pages, so it's quite short. And so on, and I used to do that too. So our procedure in the morning was, we would come into grandfather's room. First uncle would have a chance to finish his tract, and then I would have a chance to finish my tract. And after that we could eat. So it was a very interesting situation. It had a lot of sidelines to it. For example, at times when we visited my uncle and my aunt in Berlin more than once, although I remember particularly well only two trips there. And during those trips, we would have to come home for Passover. So we'd come home on the International Express. The National Express, one could sleep. I would climb up into my berth. I would have already studied as much as I could have. I was ready as I would ever be. Killed. My uncle would then, I would see him standing up with his head high on his head, his hat pushed back, reading rapidly from a little volume of the Talmud. There is an edition of the Talmud which was done by Chorev. It was printed in Germany and it was printed. There are four volumes for the total Talmud. So every volume contains many, many of them on very thin paper. And so I remember him standing there with that Chorev in hand, saying the words very rapidly, as I was going to sleep. Then by the morning, he would be ready. course, being an evil character, I would occasionally watch him, even after I was supposedly asleep. And I won't say what I saw. Anyway, that's the beginning of Passover. You asked about other holidays.
Was there anything, did you particularly enjoy about any particular holiday?
You enjoy some aspects of it, sure. I mean, Passover, the preparation is somewhat enjoyable, somewhat bothersome. And the Rosh Hashanah, of course, one is waiting for the Almighty to judge one, so it's not a time for enjoyment, it's a time for concern. Erev Yom Kippur, look at it in various ways. There's the spiritual way, and there is the very simple way, namely if one doesn't eat that day. There's Sukkot, which is a joyful holiday, and there's a sukkah to build and to cover it, and all kinds of things that go on. And then there's Shmini Atzeres, when one dances and dances and dances. So that's very enjoyable. And the whole Sukkot and Shmini Atzeres is a time for joy. In fact, in the prayers, we always characterize the Yom Tov. In the Shmoneh Esrei or the Nidah, we say, Zman Simchaseinu, the time of our joy. We say that both for Sukkot and for Shmini Atzeres. So that's the joyful one. There are other secondary holidays. There's Purim, when one is supposed to be, when one is ritually supposed to be drunk, so one doesn't know the difference between Baruch, Mordechai, and Arur Haman. There is Hanukkah, one has a chance to light beautiful candles. And then there are the typically Hasidic holidays, the days when the Alter Rebbe came out of Tsarist jail. Day, for example, when my grandfather when his sentence was commuted, so he no longer faced execution. That's Yud Beis Tammuz, 12 days in Tammuz. That also happened to be his birthday.
How do you celebrate those holidays?
Get-togethers, singing, drinking to some extent. Interestingly enough, the Hasidim, at least our kinds of Hasidim, used to drink quite a bit without necessarily getting very drunk. It was a very common habit, although nowadays it's not encouraged.
Growing up, what exposure did you have to other groups of Hasidim?
Relatively small. I was a curious guy, so every once in a while on Shabbos afternoon I would go visiting to other rebbes who were around. And there was a very substantial difference this is the difference between Hasidut Chabad and other forms of Hasidut. Hasidut Chabad, the Alter Rebbe, was an exceptionally learned man in non-mystical aspects of the law, and that was the legalism's aspects, the legal aspects. Other aspects of the Talmud, other aspects of the Jewish Jewish literature. And various, in the philosophical aspects of it. His works erect a formal structure for Hasidus, which is not present elsewhere. So, I have found the other groups that I visited to be lacking in substance. Now, that's a personal view. It is probably somewhat prejudiced. and one should not overinterpret it. In those days, when my understanding of things was quite limited, I found them rather lacking in substance. I don't know whether I would still have the same point of view. I may have had some a different perspective now, because I have seen what some of those groups have accomplished in their own way. So I was, at the time, I was making a hasty judgment.
Which groups were you exposed to in Poland?
Since I've already made somewhat critical comments, I would rather not name names, because I don't want them to be remembered that way.
In yeshiva, were you exposed to your classmates? Where were they from?
All over. Some of the kids were from the very poorest of homes. Some of them didn't have the money to come to the yeshiva, and they would have to walk for 100 miles or so.
Did they all follow the same philosophy or different ones?
Well, in the yeshiva, they did. But later, I mean, no one has exactly the same philosophy as another person. So there were changes, there were differences.
What about your attire? How did you dress growing up?
Like a bad boy. In my early, as a youngster, it was common for youngsters of that age to dress in short pants and long socks, and that was how I was dressed. Short pants being to the knee, not really short. But I never wore a black coat. I never wore a black coat. Now, the black coat was not common in Russia. Gray, yes, but not black. In Poland, it was much more so.
And your father and your grandfather?
Well, that's a different subject. Let me do that on the next roll.
Okay. Interview with Barry Gourary, tape number 4. We were talking about the mode of dress.
Yes.
And I asked you about how your father and grandfather dressed.
Yes. Well, the mode of dress varies from one country to another. I don't remember on my own what the mode of dress was in Russia. In Latvia, the mode of dress was, for men, was gray suit with a double-breasted jacket, not a long coat. In Latvia, the mode of dress for that was in Latvia, I'm sorry. In Poland, the mode of dress for a Hasidic person was a black coat, almost ankle long, or at least mid-calf long. So right there, you have a difference. And there are degrees of difference, of course. Now, in addition to the color, the material, in Poland, the Sabbath coat, or the Yontef coat, would be made out of silk. The weekday coat would be a cloth, which was not a silk, necessarily. In between, you find all kinds of gradations. Some people would dress in silk all the time. That was usually a rebbe. That would be typical of a rebbe in Poland. It would be in silk, and it would be a long coat all the time. A chassid in Poland, many of them would not wear silks during the week, but they would wear still a long black coat. Some of them would wear just black jackets, black pants, of course. Some Hasidic groups in Poland were white socks, especially the Rebbe would wear white socks, and possibly white underpants. Because of the very long coat, those underpants served like pants. So there was a whole range of dress. And generally, the Lubavitcher Hasidim who came from Russia tended to wear gray jackets. The ones who were in Poland would wear black and would occasionally wear silk. My grandfather always wore a black jacket, as I remember. But I don't remember him wearing silk except on holidays in the early years. Later, there was more silk. But again, we were in a different country. My father, again, the same thing, but in Poland, certainly in Latvia, I don't remember him wear long coat that much. For myself, I took advantage to stay as gray as I could, if you will, within the permissible bounds.
What do you remember most about your grandfather's shul?
What I remember most about my grandfather's shul was that it wasn't the shul that was important, it was the people. His grandfather, it was the kind of relationship he had with his followers. And the shul was a shul. The shul was a place which became holy by containing the right people.
What was your bar mitzvah like?
My bar mitzvah was in Natvotsk, even though we at the time still lived in Warsaw. It was probably at the yeshiva, at least that's my recollection. I remember that a number of notables came there because of my grandfather, obviously. It has been a custom in my years in Chabad for the bar mitzvah boy to repeat one of the ma'amarim of the Rebbe. And so I had studied and was ready to repeat it properly. And I remember that quite a number of different rebbes came to that gathering. Where was it? Was it the yeshiva? Was it a plain table? Not necessarily a very elegant table. I think that it did have a tablecloth on it, which would indicate that it was regarded as a kind of a holiday. The treat in those days used to be something like herring, cut up herring, and maybe a little mashke. Mashke is the Hebrew word for a drink, but it is used primarily for vodka. And that's about it.
Who were the notables who attended?
For the life of me, I don't remember. I mean, obviously my grandfather, obviously my father, obviously some of the elder Hasidim, but who were the other notables that were there? With all due respect, this is a sign of bad memory on my part. Now, just as an excuse, let me point out that was 61 years ago. So, memories do fade.
What about your extended family, your aunts and uncles? Did you see them frequently?
Well, both my uncles on my mother's side would always come, and my aunts on mother's side would always come for Yontif to my grandfather. On various special occasions, they stayed there for much longer periods. My aunts and my uncles on my father's side, I remember Sonia, who was one of his sisters, who was a very smart and learned woman, very unusual in those days. The education of Russian Orthodox women had been intentionally neglected in those years. But she had studied on her own. She was very smart. She married a man by the name of Rosenblum, and she had two daughters. Last I've checked, both of them were living in Israel. Her husband had passed away. Now, he had also a number of brothers. I forget now how many children there were in the family, but I think there was close to 10. So I remember one of them, Yisrolik, or Yisrolik is diminutive for Israel. He was a man with was looking for various kinds of occupations, as was so typical of many Jews in those days, was having his problems. He had a nice family. He lived in Warsaw, didn't survive, nor did his family. I also remember another one by the name of Nazi, Nazi being in this case a diminutive for Nosson, Natan. And I shouldn't use the word Nazi because it has other implications which are in no way connected with him. It was just a Russian nickname applied to him, and it anteceded the German movement. So there's no intention to apply that to him. But I remember him. He was sort of difficult, and he was a difficult person. He had a difficult life. Still has a daughter survived.
As an only child, were you particularly close to any of your cousins, or did you have any particularly close friends?
No. I don't recommend being an only child.
And how did your father support the family?
Well, it's the same story. My father was learned in Hasidus and in Nigle, so-called Nigle being the open part of the Bible. That's not the mystical part, not the Kabbalistic part, but the so-called open part. He was very learned in both of those areas. His parents had been involved in some kind of trade. Again, there were all kinds of limitations on Jews doing various things in Russia. In the years I remember, in the early years while we were in Riga and in the early years in Poland, he had tried various aspects of the diamond trade. Not making the diamond, but selling it, buying and selling. Later, he and mother spent a year in Israel trying to establish a business. What he was trying to do was to invest in various in land and buy and sell. Neither of these two was that successful. Then, in the middle 30s, he became the head of the yeshiva in Tvotsk. And he worked long and hard at that. In fact, he worked at that particular job until the end of his days. He was quite successful in raising funds for the yeshiva. He was moderately successful in his administrative activities.
You mentioned a year in Israel. Did you go to Israel?
No, I stayed in Poland. And I was in my grandfather's house. Mendel and Musia stayed in Poland for that particular period. So that was another opportunity for me to get a little closer with Mendel and Musia Schneerson, especially Mendel. He was at the time a student. This was already See, my bar mitzvah was in 36, so this must have been about 1935. And in 1935, he had already left Berlin, and he was by now a student at the École Normale, at least I think it was the École Normale in Paris. He was studying electrical engineering. The electrical engineering in those days entailed large rotating machinery. And every engineer had to have a way of putting his ideas into visible form. Someone had to learn drafting. Well, he had studied drafting, and he was at that time in Warsaw. He was busy preparing various proposals or whatever. I don't know exactly what. But I used to sit for hours and look at how he did the drafting and try to ask about all kinds of technical aspects of this. I found that this was probably closer to my own natural interests than were many of the other things that I was studying.
Did you pursue those interests?
Well, I finished high school, it was in 1942. And while I was still at the yeshiva, what I did then was spend about half a year or so studying more intensively at the yeshiva, and getting into the studies I would need in order to get a smicha, or an ordination as a rabbi. And then I entered Brooklyn College. That was probably in the fall of 43, as I remember correctly. And in college, I originally was going to go for a pre-engineering curriculum. In fact, I was thinking of electrical engineering. Now, as it turned out, if I had gone for pre-engineering, I could take pre-engineering at Brooklyn College, which was reasonably close. If I wanted to get into the engineering program directly, I would have to go to City College. We lived in Brooklyn. From Brooklyn to City College, it's a long haul. So I was very happy that they had a pre-engineering program in Brooklyn. Of course, I got into the pre-engineering program in Brooklyn, and I got interested in various other subjects. One of them that I had to take was physics. And I got interested in physics. So after a while, I decided to switch my major from engineering to physics. And that was the field I pursued, actually. Physics I could study at Brooklyn College. I didn't have to move to City College of New York, CCNY.
Getting back to Poland in the 30s, did you evidence your interest then?
I'm sure I did in one way or another, although there were no specific items come to mind. No specific occasions, but I certainly had a much stronger interest in that than I did in the other studies that I was pursuing. Now, interestingly enough, now that the years have gone on and I've had an opportunity to look at various sides of the picture, I now have much more of an interest in things like law and sociology, which at one time I would have looked at and shrugged, and psychology for that matter. But that, I think, comes partly with age and varied experience.
In the 30s in Poland, what awareness did you have of Hitler's rise to power in Germany?
Well, we had it partly because we kept on hearing about various things that were happening to Jews. We've heard that we, of course, visited, Mother and I both visited Germany. And we knew that Uncle had to depart from Germany and go to France. My other uncle, Mendel, Menachem Mendel Hornstein, also went to France, never went to Germany. So we were generally aware of that. We were aware to some extent towards the end of the threat that Germany presented. But I can't say that I was an expert in that area.
Your parents had gone to Palestine. Was there ever talk about emigrating in the 30s?
Yes. That was what my father wanted to do. He wanted to establish himself in a way so he would be dependent on, so he would be an independent operator, if you will. But life didn't turn out that way. So he ended up going back, and while he was in Poland, my grandfather always adroitly managed to bring one thing or another to his attention until he got him interested in doing something about the issue. And from then on, that's how it went. Now, my uncle was a little harder to persuade. He was in France. And he had very definitely made up his mind he was going to be in a different field. It wasn't until he came to the United States in 1941. And then his father died soon thereafter. By that time, he had the problem that, one, he didn't have a very good job here. Number two, he wasn't going to school here. Number three, he had to say Kaddish every day, three times a day. And so gradually sort of got into doing the things that he had to do for the next few months. Well, grandfather gave him some work to do. Publish this, publish that, edit such and such a thing, edit such and such a thing. Gradually there came in an organization called Merkaz L'Inyanei Chinuch, Center for Educational Matters, and which was largely a publishing house. And so he sort of persuaded Uncle to be temporarily the head of it. The temporary turned into a permanent occupation.
Where were you when the Germans invaded Poland in 39?
Well, the first I knew about it, I was sitting in my bed getting dressed. I was going to the yeshiva. And then I heard some peculiar noises which sounded as if there were bombs were falling. So I ran to the window, couldn't see a thing. I ran out into the yard, looked up, and there I could see a dogfight. Or at least what looked like a dogfight. And I saw there were bombs falling. And about an hour later, people came and told us that, sent us, the orphanage had been hit by some of the earliest bombs. It wasn't completely destroyed, but there was damage and casualties.
What did you do at that point?
Well, I wasn't really the one who was making decisions at that point. But the family, my grandfather, decided fairly quickly that the way to do it was to get into a place from which he could organize a savings organization for Polish Jews. So that's really savings organizations to save Jews in various countries, something in which he specialized against his desire. History imposed it on him. He, as an individual, would have been probably happier to work quietly with a small group of people. He was forced into becoming more and more public. He was forced in enlarging his activities, largely because of his commitment to the task, which was making sure that religious Jewry survived, and in fact other members of the Jewish group survived. So he concluded that he had to get out and start this kind of work. The obvious way was to go to Latvia, because we were all Latvian citizens, all except for Menzik and Sonia. Unfortunately, Menzik and Sonia had come to visit that particular summer. They had come to visit their respective parents, so they both were in Atvosk. So we went to Latvia because of that. Now, going to Latvia was not a simple task. The bombs, originally we started packing, grandmother had a large balabatiskaite. A balabatiskaite is, of course, the household. And she wanted to preserve all of that. Grandfather had a sizable library, and he wanted to preserve that. And the mentality still was not that of the Blitzkrieg, but the mentality of the First World War, where movements would be slow. They would occur within years rather than within days. Well, it took about a week or 10 days before they were ready to go to Warsaw. I went to Warsaw. Unfortunately, by then, the direct route from Warsaw to Riga, that particular railroad was bombed out. Excuse me. So we were trapped in Warsaw for the duration. At first, we stayed with one of the Hasidim. It was one of the members of the Shmotkin family, probably Mendel Shmotkin, at Muranovska 32. That was a large apartment house, shaped more or less like a rectangle, with some building in the center also. It had a number of young people living there. And those young people organized a civil defense of their own. Polish organization of civil defense was very poor. And so those we were there at first. I still remember some of those moments we spent there. We came there just before Rosh Hashanah. And I remember the Slicha service. And I remember, I mean, there is a certain yigun that goes with it. There are certain prayers that are said, but they never sounded as heartrending as they did that particular day. Zecher Bris Avrom Vakidas Yitzchok. I have no voice. And then I remember singing this for Shmuel Zalmanov. It was one of our favorite Bali Tfilah. But it then Later that day, that was early in the morning, probably at around 4 a.m. or so. Later that day, the Nazis unleashed a fire attack, a firebomb attack, onto the Jewish section of Warsaw. I remember first a bomb hitting the building across the street from Moranovska 32. We were facing the street, Moranovska. And I remember the front of the building being sheared off. A large number of victims. Then then there was this firebomb attack, and that set Warsaw on fire. And so we had to evacuate. I think I will proceed from there next time.
Just before we stop, who was with you from the time you left Otvotsk? Who was the group?
Probably my father, my mother, possibly Chaim Meir, Rabbi Chaim Meir, that was my grandfather's manservant. Probably Chaim Lieberman was my grandfather's secretary librarian. And who else?
You didn't mention your grandparents. You just said your father and
mother. My grandfather. I'm sorry. My grandfather and my grandmother were at the center. I'm describing the surroundings. It's not, that doesn't come into question, so to say.
Okay. Interview with Barry Gourary, take number 5. We were talking about Warsaw under the siege, and you were starting to talk about the evacuation.
Yes, you asked me who was with us. And of course, my grandfather and my grandmother were at the center. I do not remember where my great-grandmother was at the time. She had lived separately in Otvotsk, in a different place. And I don't remember at what point she came to Poland, but to Russia, rather, at one point she came to Latvia. But I'm reasonably sure that it was on the same train we were on. I just don't remember the details. In addition to my mother, my father, and myself, there were probably Rabbi Chaim Meir, who was a retired butcher from Riga, who was serving as my grandfather's manservant. And possibly Chaim Lieberman. I know Chaim Lieberman was with us a little bit later in the story. But that's all I can remember.
And the evacuation, you said something about after the firebombing, you evacuated?
After the firebombing, or rather in the middle of the firebombing, it turned out to be too much for the defense, for the air defense that the boys in that particular compound had organized. Some of the Hasidim grabbed hold of a droshke. Droshka is a horse-drawn carriage. And they put grandfather, grandmother, and me on one of them. Then they got another one for other members of the family. And we were told to go to a clinic, which was in an area which was not so much in the middle of the Jewish area. We went there, we got there, and I remember that particular Rosh Hashanah evening. Normally, on Rosh Hashanah night, grandfather would spend probably 3 or 4 hours in his Maariv prayer. His much prayer, many tears. Then this time it turned out he was totally exhausted. He had to sit. He couldn't stand up physically. He couldn't stand up for his prayers. His prayers took half an hour. He was completely self-controlled. His eyes were dry, and he was reassuring everybody around him. Remarkable strength of character from a man who was unable to move for physical reasons. Later that night, some Hasidim got together. They found a man who lived in the area on Granichna Street. And his name was, if I remember it correctly, probably Bornstein. Maybe Bernstein, probably Bornstein. And he gave my grandfather his apartment for the next week or two. So we moved there, and we by then had a minyan on Rosh Hashanah morning. After the firebombing of the previous night, that was quite an accomplishment for people to be able to do that. Rosh Hashanah was difficult. The days after that were difficult because of the various bombardments. Then came Yom Kippur. And then Yom Kippur around Yom Kippur afternoon, by that time the Nazis had brought their artillery much closer to the city. So they were no longer dependent on aerial bombs. They could actually blast the city from their long-range guns, which they did. And they did that most intensively during Ne'ilah time. Ne'ilah being the prayer offered in the late afternoon. I remember the fires and the horror, and now we had to get out. Granichna Street was being hit badly. Now, in between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, a cousin of mine named Yankov Gourary, who didn't survive the Shoah, and I went around trying to look for a wheelchair. Grandfather had never sat in a wheelchair before. He refused. We found one, found a used wheelchair. We paid for it well, and we brought it and hid it, so Grandfather wouldn't see it. That afternoon, we got him to sit down on it. And it was very helpful in helping us get out of Granichna. Walking across ruins, a burning city, we finally made it to Nalevki 7. Nalevki 7 was again one of those large tenements which had a big opening in the middle, sort of built like an O, but with not round corners, but square corners. It was built like a square, I should say. And it had a very, very deep cellar. We finally made it there, and we finally were able to get down. That took some pleading by our friends. Many of them lived in Nalevki 7. So that the Poles who were in charge of that particular shelter would let us in. We managed to make it down that particular shelter. We stayed there until Erev Sukkot. Erev Sukkot in the morning, it was quiet. Somehow we found out that there was some kind of a Waffenstillstand, I forgot the name, cessation of hostilities, temporary cessation of the hostilities. I'm searching for the right word. And We got out, we looked around. It was so good to see the sun, smell the air. That was our first moment above ground, if you will. There were no sukkahs. No, there was a holiday of Sukkot, but there were no sukkahs that year in Warsaw. Normally, Nalev Kisavim would have been flooded with them. But the understanding was that the German army was poised outside of Warsaw, and they would shortly come in. I don't remember exactly when they came in. But things started happening. All kinds of things that would make Jews feel miserable. One of their favorite activities in those days, at the very beginning, was to catch a Jew with a large beard and cut off half of it. Half of it being from one ear to the middle of the chin. Occasionally they would take an ear along. Now they expected those people to become laughing stock. They weren't, they were heroes. Father got caught in one of those. After Sukkot, we moved to an apartment which was away from Nalevki. The problem was that we had heard that the SS was looking for Schneerson. And it wasn't clear to us whether it was with benign intentions, but one never took the risk of assuming that the SS was doing anything benign for Jews. As it turned out, we moved to the apartment of a man by the name of Herschel Gourary. He was a distant cousin of my father's and mine. He lived away from the center of the Jewish area, and he was willing to let us stay with him. He had three rooms. These were walk-through rooms. No corridor. And they had a kitchen. And he, his wife, Toibe, and four grown children. Yankel, Zalman, Nossen, and his daughter. All lived there with him. And yet he was able to find room for us. In fact, he gave grandfather and grandmother his larger room, which had a large table also. He gave us the second room, and the six of them fitted into one room. Sometimes some of them slept over with friends in the building. And that's where we stayed for a number of weeks. During the day, grandfather would sit at the table, at the head of the table, and would be doing something. Whenever there was a difficult period, grandfather would tend to organize himself and write, do something specific, concrete. In this case, he was writing Ma'amorim, he was writing Siches, and people were copying this and they were giving it out to his followers. Others sat around the same table. And each one of us did whatever one could. I spent some time copying various Ma'amorim. My father was very busy in those days. He was trying to get somehow, on the one hand, let our friends in America know what the situation was. On the other hand, make sure that he didn't tip his hand to the SS. Well, I told you already about his experience of having half his beard cut off. That didn't stop him. And finally, one day, the SS burst in. And the manner in which they acted made us feel that that was it. We expected to have one bullet per person, preferably in the back of the head. But no, it turned out that they wanted Schneerson and they wanted to give him a visa to get out. And they wanted to give us also visas. And so that was the beginning of the move out of there.
Do you know why they gave you the visas?
Under pressure from the U.S. Again, U.S. was still at peace with the Germans. Latvia was a neutral country. Of course, as far as Latvia was concerned, they regarded Latvia as, they regarded us who were citizens of Latvia, they referred to us as Vansenburger. Vans is a bedbug. Burger is a citizen. We are citizens of a bedbug, referring to the size, obviously. In addition to the fact, it's always nice to see something about a Jew. Unfortunately, none of our hosts, Herschel or his three sons or his daughter or his wife, survived. They all perished. So I have a feeling I've forgotten something, but some parts of the story.
Well, we were talking about when the SS came in and gave you visas to leave.
Yes. And I remember also my father was trying to negotiate another visa, you know, along the way. Except that interesting, and then towards the end when he had successfully completed the negotiation, he put out his hand to shake hands. The German wouldn't do that. It's shaking the hand of a Jew. It's inappropriate. I forgot one thing that I should mention. During the very worst period, just before, between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, I think it was, there was an evacuation of foreign citizens from Warsaw. Official evacuation. We had 2 hours' notice. Grandfather couldn't survive that kind of an evacuation. It was in trucks. He was immobile. It wasn't possible. So mother and the rest of us decided we were staying with him. However, we talked Chaim Lieberman into being evacuated because we felt that that would be one way of communicating with the outsiders, with our friends outside. Chaim Lieberman didn't want to go, but finally bowed to that. He was a Latvian citizen. And so the Latvia got word that way, and so did America, of course, of grandfather's situation. Well, now coming back, we're now in a situation where we have exit visas. We have grandfather who has a large beard. We have father who has half a beard. We have the rest of the people who look like they're Jews. What's the chance that we can get out of Warsaw with a permit? The answer was that probably not very good. And so what the problem was getting an escort who somehow could get us out of there. Excuse me for a moment. And again, father was the one who managed to the trick of getting that kind of a person. I'm not quite sure now what he was. He apparently had at one time served in some part of the German SS or some part of the... I'm not sure where, but he had served in some kind of official activity. He was very interested in money. And he could he could undergo a metamorphosis at any point. He could speak as if he were from High Deutsch, Hochdeutsch. He could speak a different language. He could make himself appear anything that suited the particular moment. And he was willing to escort us to Lithuania. Well, this man helped us get onto the train. And I still remember sitting in the compartment trying to sort of sink into the wall. And German officers passing through the walk, the corridor, and saying, why should you sit in a compartment while we German officers are, you know, and I remember that guy talking them out of it. I don't know what he said, but he managed to talk them out of it. We got to Berlin. It was after the curfew time. We managed to get two taxis to take us to the nearest place we could go to, namely the Jüdisches Gemeindehaus, which means the Jewish community house. Now that was a picture of a large and prosperous community which had been reduced to nothing. We were there in a large hall, and there were poor people there with difficulty, who couldn't eat, didn't have what to eat, who couldn't stand up because they had been beaten down so much. The sight was absolutely horrid. Finally, somehow, we got a place in a small motel. Again, money speaks. And our friends in Warsaw had made sure that we had enough of it. Get through. And we managed to stay there over Shabbos. And then we took the train, again with this guy, with the escort. The train took us first to West Prussia, it's East Prussia, to Königsberg, and then to Kaunas in Lithuania, and then to Riga. And I never remember welcoming a border guard to the extent that we welcomed those Lithuanian border guards. It's as if we were being let out of the worst jail in the world. Those were not very friendly people. Lithuanians in general had a tendency to hate Jews. They still do. But under the circumstances, they were godsend. Then we finally got to Riga. Riga was peaceful, quiet, and you could see a palpable, somehow, cover of fear. Who knows what's going to happen next? You could feel it all the time. Soon after we came to Riga, grandfather stumbled. Grandfather was being led all this time by hand by somebody because he couldn't do it by himself, with a cane also, on the other hand. He stumbled and he fell and he broke his arm. So he had to go to the sanitarium to recover. Otherwise, it wasn't so clear that he could make it to the trip. He did. In the meantime, we determined that Riga was no place to stay, and that Riga would not be a place from which grandfather could mount any kind of organized rescue effort. It was too close. We could almost feel the German fingers and the Russians on the other side. So the conclusion was that we decided to leave. We being, in this case, grandfather, on information supplied by father and various other senior people. And we decided to go to the U.S. This trip to the U.S. had to take place via Sweden. We had to have an air connection from Riga to Stockholm, train to Göteborg, which was a larger port, and there we would board a ship, the Drottninghall, which would take us to New York. Sweden was neutral at the time. Riga was neutral at the time. So that was still feasible. I don't know how they got us a space on the plane, because planes were full. There were not that many planes, and they were not that big in those days. And I have to tell you a little humorous story. My father had been told that flying was still a dangerous thing. So he first made sure it got it, my grandfather's blessing for the flight. And then he had heard that chewing helps so that one's ears don't. So there he was, sitting in his seat, chewing furiously, with big white kerchief stuffed in his ears so that the pressure wouldn't affect him too much, and asking everybody around him whether that was sufficient to get him get those through. Again, this is the same man, however, who also, man, it was totally fearless when it came to getting, to going into the most dangerous places in order to get us out of Warsaw. But this was a very comical moment. And we should have a few light moments sometimes. We came to Stockholm, and if I remember correctly, I am very bad at names and I may be making a mistake, there was a Rabbi Zuber there. And he told us about the problems of the Jewish community in Sweden. Sweden was neutral, but Sweden became very much concerned about the rights of animals. So they determined that shechita, killing by ritual killing of birds, of chickens, or of animals, was not permissible because it was unfair to the animal. Therefore, there was no meat for Orthodox people. But Orthodox people did survive. Other Jews did survive in Sweden during that particular period. I remember Rabbi Zuber later coming to New York. Unfortunately, he was killed by some criminal. I don't remember the particular situation. Anyway, from Sweden, from Stockholm, we took the train to Göteborg. We took the Drottningholm, which was a Swedish ship, neutral. Remember, that was very important. And we started on the trek. Once on this trek in the Atlantic, we were stopped by a German warship. They looked, and after a while they decided it wasn't worth bothering with because it was a neutral ship from neutral country. The citizens were apparently mostly people from neutral, citizens of a neutral country, so the heck with it, they didn't bother with us. So on March 18th, I remember, was dropping anchor in the harbor of New York, close to the Statue of Liberty. It was a wonderful feeling, and yet, you know, as a young immigrant on that particular ship, I was asking myself, is there any place where a Jew would really be welcome? It wasn't clear. Well, we had a wonderful welcome on the 19th when we pulled in. Grandfather's followers came, many friends. They put us up at the Greystone Hotel, Broadway and 91st Street, and that became our home for quite a while, half a year roughly. And then for a short period during Passover, Grandfather had an invitation from one of his more distant admirers to spend the Yontif in Lakewood, which we did, but it turned out to be a limited invitation. So we went back to the Greystone Hotel. And we appointed a committee, or rather, the Agudas Chabad membership appointed a committee to look for a home for Grandfather. Finally, after about most of half a year, they found a home at 770 Eastern Parkway in Brooklyn. It was a beautiful house which was owned by a physician who was doing some things which at the time were illegal. And so he had to say, the court sold it. Grandfather got the middle floor, nice apartment. There was a shul, and a secretariat on the ground floor. And there was also a study for grandfather on the ground floor. And then on the top floor, there was an apartment, which we got. And there was one extra room, which father converted into a place for a secretary, part of the secretariat of the yeshiva. And that's where we spent quite a number of years. I, for one, spent there until after grandfather's death, which came in 1950. My parents lived there much longer than that.
You had mentioned that your grandparents packed an entire household when you left Otvotsk. Did that make it to the United States with you?
Later on, after the war, parts of it did. Parts of it did as parts of the library made it. But many things did not.
Interview with Barry Gourary, tape number 6. We were talking about settling into 770 Eastern Parkway. Before we get to that, we had talked a little about your grandparents' household items. When you left Otvotsk, was there anything special you took with you?
In that environment, what I took with me, in Otvotsk, I don't know, we packed my stuff together with everybody else's. Each one, an Orthodox Jew, carries with him a talis and a tefillin, and the cedar, things of this sort. And there were some manuscripts that were precious to me. So I had a large handbag. The bag was probably the size of it's just a large briefcase, size of an attaché case, something like that. That was what I carried with me throughout the bombings. Now, grandfather, of course, had more. He had the same kind of content in his own little bag, which was intended, again, size of a very large attaché case. And in that was his talis and tefillin and a few important manuscripts. Then, in addition to this, he had two manuscripts filled with two attaché case size things, filled with manuscripts. They're perhaps a little larger than attaché case, but the reason they were always packed in a manuscript in a attaché case is that in the years that he remembered and that I remember, house fires were not so uncommon. So very precious things used to be kept always ready to move. In fact, in the Babich, I remember being told that there were periods when they had the horses in the droshke, arranged so that the horses were put into their proper place in the droshke so that one could drive away quickly. So one could take away some of the very important things out of the fire. Well, during the foot trip from Granichna to Nalivki 7, three of the young people with us, three boys, carried these three packages, these three attaché cases. One of them was lost, the one that had my grandfather's talis and tefillin. So, grandfather borrowed my tefillin until he got himself better ones. So both of us used those. I still have those three. And those are the things that were particularly precious. Now, there were various things that were very lovely, very important, very valuable in grandmother's packages and grandfather's packages, such as life.
Getting back to Brooklyn, could you describe your adjustment to life in New York and in Brooklyn?
Well, during the first half year, when we were still in the Greystone Hotel, I was studying as much English as I possibly could, with various kinds of help. And I was walking the streets from time to time when I had a chance. I found that in general, during that period, my load in terms of helping grandfather had decreased, and it was for several reasons. First, he had a nurse who came with us from the sanitarium in Riga. Second, his care was much better organized. He needed less of mother's help, he needed less of my help. He had better medical attention, better medicines. Then I could no longer serve as well in other ways because I really wasn't that familiar with the United States. I couldn't serve in terms of helping him with Americans. I was not a suitable intermediary. So that gave me more time. I began to think about my own future. And I studied English as much as I could. Then by the time we moved to Eastern Parkway, we got the top floor, as I've already mentioned, on 770. And I began going to a regular yeshiva. Now, of course, the Lubavitcher yeshiva was being built, but the Lubavitcher yeshiva at that stage was still very makeshift, very in its very beginnings. And my grandfather, my father, and my mother all thought that it would be a good idea if I went to a place which was much more stable, just as a way of helping me have a more stable environment. I started going to Yeshiva Torah Adas in Williamsburg. And that's where I continued later my studies. Now, Yeshiva Torah Adas, of course, was an American yeshiva, and therefore it had a high school. The law requires a high school. So I started going to the yeshiva and also to the high school. And I tried to catch up. I was 17. By 17, I should have graduated high school. By 18, I was nowhere near that. So in one way or another, I started taking various subjects, home study. A year passed by, and I had taken enough of courses so I could now graduate with one more semester. The principal of Torah Vadas High School looked at me and said, "Look, you're trouble. With all these courses, home study, if I ever let you take the regents from our place, regents are going to come and they will say that I'm not running a bona fide school. It's a phony outfit. I can't afford that. You better go to another high school, graduate from it. We'll give you all the credits, but they should graduate you." I talked him into letting me finish a few regents exams at the yeshiva, and then I went to the high school. Now, that high school happened to have been an evening high school, of course, and the evening high school was in Brooklyn on Fulton Street, which was a poor black section. Turned out to be very good for me. My classmates turned out to be mostly women, mostly black, mostly day workers or maids. And they used to come there after a day's hard work. I learned to respect those people a great deal. That's what I can say. Now, after graduation from that, I began to say to think to myself, well, some people sit at a yeshiva and they study for the rest of their lives. I don't want to do that. So what do I want? Well, I want to have some kind of an appropriate endpoint. The endpoint would be smicha. Now it's ordination as a rabbi. So I studied the Yoredeya and other aspects of the Shulchan Aruch very intensively for a while. And at the same time, late in 43, I began attending Brooklyn College, evening school. So by 1945, I got smicha, and I already had a few college credits, and I was doing reasonably well. It's difficult to do well when you are a newcomer and when you study in the evenings, because it turns out you can take a maximum of 10 credits. And of course I needed at the time 120 to graduate. Now from what does that add up to? A rather large number of years. So I began to figure, what can I do to get out of there faster, get my degree faster? By now I was going there studying physics, and I gradually came to know Professor Kurlmeier. I was taking an advanced laboratory course of his. Professor Kurlmeier was the typical German. Typically, all his habits were German. His appearance was German. His father was a professor of German. He was a professor of physics. He was my professor of physics, and lo and behold, he had many Jewish students, and he was very decent to them. In fact, very kind to them. I began to see a different world. Somehow a German could be a decent person. You know, after having been through Poland and Germany, it wasn't so clear. But this man disabused me of that. And I'm grateful to him for that. In addition to that, he happened to have a wife who was also a physicist. And she was an assistant professor at Columbia. Assistant professor because in those days women didn't advance very much beyond that. But she was a smart woman. And she gave me a job as an assistant in her laboratory. First, I took her laboratory course. Even though I wasn't quite qualified for it, we sort of got around it. And then she introduced me to Professor Rabi, a very prominent physicist, who was head of the department. And she introduced me to Professor Willis Lamb. Willis Lamb was the head of the Columbia Radiation Lab, which was a contract organization in the lab, in the university. So somehow they managed to get me in as a contingent, as a conditional graduate student. So I was an assistant who was getting paid very well, $150 a month. In those days, remember this was 44, but still, $150 for half time was quite good. So I had money. And two, she talked Professor Lamb into accepting me as an assistant in his place. So I now, well, this was where I was getting the money. But she was the one who helped me with that. And then, gradually, I became a matriculated student. And I was doing very well there. Then my assistantship ran out. So I went to the math department. You know, you can have an assistantship only for 3 years. Well, I went to the math department and got myself a teaching job. Math professor, Professor Levi, looked at me and said, well, you're taking away a teaching assistantship which I would be giving to one of my students. You go back to physics. I went back to physics and complained bitterly. Somehow Professor Levi changed his mind very quickly. Seemed that he had quite a bit of pressure exercised on him. And so I was able to work as a math teacher, teaching geometry, analytic geometry, calculus to students, and at the same time study. And as soon as I got my smicha, which was my ordination from Torah Vedas, I became a day student. I became a day student in Brooklyn College. I'm confusing some things. No, but in any case, that process saved me a lot of time with getting into graduate school. Then in early 1950, in February, my grandfather passed away. And the place was now suddenly a no man's land. First, people were confused about the direction which way to go. Secondly, they were thinking about the successor. In my mind, the successor to grandfather was ridiculous. It would be a totally different place. And so some people told me, well, you're a direct descendant. I said, forget it. The choice was between father and uncle. That is my uncle Schneerson. Uncle Hornstein, of course, never made it out of Poland. He was killed there. And that was a very, very unpleasant and a vicious kind of a fight. I had been very friendly with my uncle at one time, but the kind of dirty tricks that his followers did, he at least tolerated it. Forced me to break off with him. In any case, there came a point when I began to feel that this place was coming apart, and I couldn't really, having just been through the Shoah part of it, I couldn't really stay there very much longer. So I began to look for a job. The place I was going to look at was Washington, because I'd been told that Jews could get jobs in government positions. In those days, that wasn't so obvious, you know. There were many places which still had a glass door that was firmly locked when a Jew came. And so I went for a number of interviews. I got 4 offers in Washington, and I got 1 offer at Westinghouse Atomic Research Project in Pittsburgh. And 5 offers. I took the one at the National Bureau of Standards. Now it is the National Institute of Science and Technology, which is a government organization. And very soon after I came there, I realized I had taken the wrong job. Why? Because I couldn't quite make friends. I couldn't quite make. I found it up being isolated. Not all the fault was by the bureau; it was that of the bureau. Partly it was mine. I went to Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab, which was in Silver Spring. It was a government contract organization primarily concerned with guided missiles. And it was a totally different kind of a place. The research center there was headed by a gentleman named Frank Trelford McClure, or we called him Mac. Everybody called him Mac. He was an Irishman, a Canadian Irishman with the gift of the gab. And he was delightful in many ways. It was difficult and delightful both. But in any case, I took the job there. And I made many friends there. I stayed there for almost 10 years until, well, I got married. Mina and I got married in 1953. I stayed at Johns Hopkins till 1960. And I made some of my contributions to the war effort, or to the post-war effort, which I, for one, felt was very important, because in my view, America was the one decent force in the world, and we needed strength, not just the ability to talk tough, but possibly talk softly but carry the big stick, and we needed that big stick badly. So later I switched from there to Westinghouse Research Labs. That was largely for questions of personal advancement. And we couldn't stay. Westinghouse Research was a nice place. I couldn't stay there very long because both Mina and I developed allergies. In those days, Pittsburgh had a lot of smoke and other harmful emissions in the air. And so we had to move out of there. Found a place in United Aircraft, which was in West Hartford. And that turned out to be a very nice place. And I stayed there for, what is it, about 6 years. Then I took another, again for personal advancement, I took a job in ITT. At the time it was an abbreviation for International Telephone and Telegraph, but staff members used to say the ITT stood for International Talk and Travel. It was primarily a conglomerate. It had a large defense part, but it also was buying up companies of all kinds. And I found that it was a very interesting place. I was a director of technology for the Defense Space Group there. I had to travel a good deal. It took me more into politics and less into science than I had preferred. And so after a certain period, we parted company. And by that time, I was living here. And so I started a little company called Gourary Associates, Inc., which survived until it was disbanded this year, because I'm no longer able to carry on that kind of an activity for medical reasons. Now, in the meantime, I have forgotten to mention Mina's changes.
Before you do that, could you tell me about how you met her?
How I met Mina. Well, there is the fact of life that her father and mine shared rooms at the yeshiva in Lubavitch. It's a little part of it. I met Mina, or at least what I remember, soon after we came to the United States. She probably was at the dock to welcome us. But then when we were in at the Hotel Greystone, my grandmother needed lots of help. My grandmother was totally deaf. She had become deaf during the birth of her last child, Sonia. So she really needed help in terms of doing things. And my mother needed help, and Nina was always willing to give it. And she also helped me to get acquainted with America, like helping me visit the World's Fair in 1940, various other things. Later she moved to, she completed school in the meantime. She got a master's in statistics from Columbia in 1949. And soon thereafter, she moved to Washington. She got herself a job at the Logistics Research Project at the George Washington University as a logistician. Then she went on a world tour. She had money of her own by now, so she went on a world tour. When she came back, I had, in the meantime, decided to move someplace out of New York. And I must confess that one of the thoughts in my mind when I decided on Washington was that I knew at least one person there, Mina. I came there, and she took off on her world tour, and I was furious. I couldn't say it, but I was furious. Anyway, she came back after some months, and that's how things developed.
And what was your wedding like?
Our wedding was not what I would have liked it to be. By that time, my grandfather had passed away. My uncle was sort of Rebbe, very unfriendly towards my father. I wanted my father to officiate at the wedding, not my uncle. And the only way I could do that was by not inviting uncle, which is regarded as a bad insult. Well, the result was that they made it impossible for father to attend the wedding. Such is life. We got married anyway. And Mina turned out to be a very good daughter-in-law anyway. So that's how we met. Then gradually our children came. And Mina gradually gave up her work. For the first one, she continued working. But when the second one came, she decided to stop for a while. So there was a period of about 8 or 9 years that she didn't work. But when the kids went into school, she became very bored. So she had one master's in statistics. She decided that she wanted to learn more about management. We were living in West Hartford at the time, so she went to University of Hartford and she got an MBA. And then gradually she got into the stock market. She's now still a registered representative. She's smarter than I am. She wasn't retired by illness as quickly as I was. I hope it continues. For good health, that is.
Could you tell me a little about your children?
Yes. My older one is Sonia, named in honor of my aunt, who perished in Poland. I'll have to show you her picture. She was a slow starter. She was a premature child. She was a slow starter. But she's caught up very nicely. And she has a master's degree in microbiology. She nowadays is an assistant director of regulatory affairs in a large firm. My younger one is named Nora. Actually, the correct name is Nora Sterna. Nora Sterna is not an easy name to use for daily purposes, so we added the Nora. Nora Stern. She's named after my great-grandmother. And she has taken a bachelor's degree in business administration. And then she met a young physician who, at a wedding. Interestingly enough, this was a wedding of a girl with whom she and that girl together had attended the same Jewish day school. So she was invited to that wedding. She met him. She liked him. He liked her. And so her married name is Friedman. And she lives in Teaneck now. She now has three little girls and a very busy husband. And she herself works also in the medical office. My son-in-law, as I said, is a cardiologist.
And what effect do you think your experiences have had on the way you raised your children?
Oh, it's difficult to say. It certainly had to do with the fact that we sent them to a Jewish day school because we wanted them to have a strong bond. I have not told them the story too many times. I've written it up for them. You've seen the write-up. But I have not tended to, because I feel that so much of it, I didn't want to convey a message of hate. Care, yes, being very careful. making sure you know where you are, you know with whom you are, you provide for yourself, and you always know who your real friends are. But I want to avoid hate.
We'll continue on the next tape. Interview with Barry Gourary, tape number 7. After so many years, did you ever return to Poland or Germany after the war?
During my years at ITT, I had to do some travel, some of it to Germany. I never returned to Berlin. I don't remember anymore where I went. I think München, possibly Frankfurt. And I just got out of there as soon as I could. In general, I've also been in France, in Belgium. I have no love for Europe.
And have you ever been back to Russia at all?
No. In principle, if I'm a native of Russia, who had the citizenship in Russia at one time, and I'm a naturalized citizen of the United States, I also have dual citizenship. I trust the Russians with everything. Except my return ticket. Maybe I'm being pessimistic about it, but anyway, I had no particular need to.
And
this is purely a personal, emotional reaction. It is not necessarily a rational reaction. I do not feel that everybody should feel that way about those countries. But for me, that's how I feel.
You had mentioned back in the interview, earlier in the interview, that your parents had gone to Palestine in
1935,
in the 30s. What was your reaction to the establishment of the State of Israel?
Well, my reaction was one of joy, hope, and foreboding. That doesn't represent necessarily the point of view of the movement, of the Chabad movement. Joy, obviously. Hope, obvious. Foreboding, because I have then had my doubts and I still have my concerns about the future of Israel in the part of the world in which it is situated. When a country is completely surrounded by enemies who do not change, the future is very cloudy. I hope for the best.
Now that it's 50 years, almost 60 years after the war, you went through a lot of different changes in your life. Is there a message that you would like to leave for your children and for posterity?
Well, I suppose one can make up various kinds of messages. I'll make one up that would fit Wall Street. Always make sure that you have adequate means, or that you can get adequate means, because those will help you out. Try to forecast a little bit the political situation so that you don't find yourself in the worst place in the world. And make sure you have many friends, real friends. Those who will stand by you even in troubled periods. But one also has to think about the other side. When you see a despot, when you see an aggressive state like Germany, make sure you stop them early enough and finally, so that there's no question whatsoever about what the outcome will be. I applaud, for example, the war we fought in the Middle East, I mean America, to bloody the nose of the tyrants. We should have perhaps cut off a few more heads. But that kind of an approach is the right one sometimes, even though I don't like wars.
Is there anything we haven't talked about that you'd like to add?
Nothing I can think of except that my wife is doing now.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Could you introduce your wife, please?
Indeed, it's my pleasure. This is the young lady who introduced me to America, as I already mentioned to you. She's the daughter of Baruch Haskind, who was my father's roommate at the yeshiva in Lubavitch. And interestingly enough, she's decided to be my life mate.
So I pursued you until you decided to pursue me.
Okay.
Minna, I know you were born in Russia. When did you come to this country?
I came here in May of 1939.
And how did you
get here? We left Russia in early in the 30s, and we spent 4 years in Palestine. And then we came here.
And how do you feel about your husband doing this interview?
What do you mean?
Well, what do you think, you know, what are your thoughts about him doing this interview?
Oh, I think it should be recorded for posterity, especially for our children. I would like them to see it because they don't know very much and they don't have any connection with the what happened with the events that happened before. That's about it.
Is there anything either of you would like to add?
I beg your
pardon? Is there anything either of you would like to add?
No, I don't know what he said, but I'm sure it's all 100% correct.
Well,
I don't know what I can add.
Nina has brought up two very lovely daughters. I'm very grateful to her for that. And she has done a lot of other things for me in life, for which I'm very grateful.
Thank you.
My best friend.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, our families were very close. Every holiday, every Passover, every Rosh Hashanah, we lived across the street from 770 at 763 Eastern Parkway. We used to spend in their house, in the grandfather's house. You know, there was men were in one room, the women in the other, and that's how I learned to do dishes. Grandmother was, you know, quite a lady, but she knew how to supervise. And you know, we would have 20, 25 people, and if there was nobody there, we had to do the dishes. I'm a fantastic dishwasher. You think it's a joke, that's true. Besides, I learned a great deal from her. She said the most beautiful table. She was a lady. And she liked beautiful things, and so did my mother-in-law. And over the years, I learned. I spent more time in their house than in my own house. So that's how. Well,
thank you both.
Pleasure. This is a portrait of my mother, Hanna Gourary, born Schneerson, in her later years.
Could you describe this, please?
This is a picture of my grandmother with her three daughters. From left to right, they are Musia, who is the middle daughter, Sonia, who is the youngest, my grandmother, and then my mother, Hanna. Now, this picture was taken probably in the early 1900s, like maybe 1912, 1915, somewhere in that area. And it was taken in Germany, apparently.
And could you state your grandmother's name, please?
My grandmother is Nechama Dina Schneerson.
And this picture?
This is a picture of my great-grandmother, Sterne Sore Schneerson, and her great-grandson, namely myself. I was probably about 6, 7 years old in that picture. So we're talking about something that was done at the very end of the 1920s.
Maybe earlier.
This picture? And this picture?
This is a picture of yours truly, Barry Gourary, and two partners. Well, almost partners. They are really panther or tiger cubs. One is sitting on my lap, the other one lying at my feet, courtesy of the Berlin Zoo. And the reason I got this particular picture was that my uncle, Mendel Schneerson, used to take me to the zoo. And he used to entertain me in various ways. This was one of them.
And approximately when was this?
This was about 1931, 1932.
And this picture?
This picture shows my grandfather, the Lubavitcher Rebbe, Admur Yisef Yitzchok Schneerson on the left, and my father, Rav Shmaryo Gourary, on the right. It was taken probably in the very early 1930s, probably soon after they returned from the U.S., maybe even during the trip.
And this?
This is a picture of my youngest aunt on mother's side. She is Sonia Hornstein, but at the time she wasn't married yet, so she was still Sonia Schneerson. It was taken probably 1930s, very early 1930s, before her wedding.
And this picture?
This is a picture of the Hornstein clan. Unfortunately, all of them perished in Poland. Seated from the left to the right, I'm uncertain about the identity of the first person. The next one is Musia Chaya Muska, or Musia Hornstein. She was the daughter of the Rebbe, the Maharash. And her husband comes next, Meisha Hornstein. Then is Shmuel Hornstein. Standing is first from the left. Pinchas Landa, Bronka Hornstein, Menachem Mendel Hornstein, and Sarah Lees. The young man, the third one from the right standing, Menachem Mendel Hornstein, is my uncle. He married my aunt Sonia. Unfortunately, none of them survived the Shoah.
And approximately when and where was this?
By the looks of things, this must have been taken probably in the late 20s, maybe very early 30s. This is a picture of my grandfather, Admur Yisef Yitzchok Schneerson, Zichrona Livracha. Admur meaning our master, our teacher, the rabbi Yosef Yitzchak Shnei Yosef. He was the former Lubavitcher Rebbe. This picture was taken by myself with a camera, which grandfather gave me as a gift. And it was taken at 770 Eastern Parkway during the very early 1940s, probably around 1942 or thereabouts. Now, soon following this will be another picture taken at essentially the same sitting. This is the second picture in the same series. Taken at the same sitting, essentially, with the previous one. And it shows grandfather in a somewhat more somber mood. This is a picture of my grandfather getting his citizenship papers. The person seated is obviously my grandfather, Admor Yosef Yitzchok Schneerson. Standing from the left is the lawyer Sam Kramer, who was an old friend of the Schneerson family. A gentleman who is a judge who came to this especially to grandfather's study because grandfather couldn't physically go to the court. Rabbi Chadakov, one of the functionaries, my uncle, Mendel Schneerson, and Nissan Mindel.
And approximately when was this?
Well, my grandfather got his papers in 1945 or so.
Okay. And this?
This is a picture of my wife, Mina Haskin Gourary, and on the left, and her father, Beryl Haskin, on the right. Probably, in fact, on the day of the wedding, it seems, judging by the dress, which would put it into May of 1953. Shows my father, Rabbi Shmaryohu Gourary, or Rabbi Samarius Gourary, if you prefer the English name. He's shown at his office in the yeshiva, and this picture was taken in the early 1980s. This is a wedding picture, taken at the wedding of my younger daughter. Seated in front are mother, Hannah Gourary, and next to her on the right, Mina, my wife. And standing on the left is the bride, Nora Sterna Gourary, who at that point became Friedman, and her husband, Yeshua Heschel Friedman, also known as Dr. Samuel Friedman. Then I stand next to him, and I'm Barry Gourary, just in case you've forgotten. And last on the right is now Sonia Gourary, my elder daughter. This is a picture of my granddaughters. The first one on the left is Miri. The baby is Nava. And the one on the right is Hannah. Picture was taken about 2 years ago. That would put it in 1995.